And then it won't spoil the day. We can go out cycling after that. We did a good ride, about 80 mile that day, I think, with a few friends. It's a good test for a couple to try tandem riding. You do get rough times, you know. You get the weather and the things go wrong and all like that. And if you can take your girl or your fiancé on a tandem tour, say, give her a week or a fortnight, and when she gets cold, wet and hungry and all the glamour's gone... All right, behind?
Yes.
Right up. If you're still friends, you know, you've got a good basis for a married life.
Well, the first slide is after I arrived at Oslo, which is where the boat pulled in, I got off the boat and was looking for the hostel, and some road menders who I asked the way very kindly picked the bike up, put it on the lorry and dropped me right off at the hostel gates. And this is the youth hostel in Oslo, which is at the top of a big park near the tram depot. The next one is the actual tram depot. They've got double trams, you'll notice there.
Well, the actual decision must have been the first day back after the Christmas break. And we came back and you sat in an office and you think, you know, really, there must be more to it than this. There's just got to be.
It's been a burning ambition of mine since my late teens. And it's something which I've sort of always sort of knew I would do sometime, and now's the right time.
And although we both enjoy our jobs, and it is a challenge, we decided that one day we just rung each other up and decided that we wanted to do something else, and we both said the same thing. Why don't we do it? Why don't we cycle around the world?
Well, we've sold everything. There's everything. We've stored a few sentimental items with his parents.
Tapes.
Yeah, tapes. And I'm keeping some of my stereo, which has taken a long time to build. But apart from that, everything's been sold. Furniture, the house is gone. We'll own what we set off to New York with, which is basically his bikes, a tent, sleeping bags, and various other bits of essential equipment.
Since we first met, which was 12 years ago now, we joined a cycling club at the same time, Hill and Valley Wheelers, and we cycled all the time, even if it's just to get from A to B. I've cycled to Tech, to work, and I've done a bit of racing as well. And yes, we really have always been cyclists. We've always had a bike. To not have a bike is, you know, it's a crime.
The journey would take 2.5 years, starting by cycling across America, east to west. And then we go over to Hawaii for a 2-week break, a holiday at Christmas, and then to Fiji for the New Year. And then we do 2.5 months cycling in New Zealand, then on to Australia, Japan, and then into Far East Asia.
Some people want, you know, a better car, they want a nice kitchen and all the materialistic things, and we just weren't interested. We just thought there's got to be more than just going out and spending money on things that just aren't really important. We're like best friends, really, more than husband and wife, if you like, and I think we just get on great all the time. And we'll just support each other, we're a team.
If anything, it'll strengthen the relationship. I'm sure there'll be trying times, but I'm sure we'll battle through that.
I'd just like to tell you that my guest on the Pete Murray Show today is Jeremy Vanker from the London Cycling Campaign. Whatever your question or point about bikes or cycling, now's the time to ring. Go straight to David of Wimbledon. Good afternoon, David.
It's obvious to me, and it must be obvious to anyone, that modern city traffic is totally unsuitable for cycling. They're vulnerable, they seem to have a predilection for coming up on you when you're not expecting to see them. They provoke drivers into unsafe driving. So I don't see how any responsible person can contemplate taking a bike out into heavy traffic.
It dramatically reduces the time taken to get to work, and it's an environmentally very benign form of transport. It makes comparatively few demands on the environment. I live about 4 miles from my office, and you would think that that is ideal, but in fact, that journey has taken me up to an hour and a quarter to do by public transport, which is barely more than walking speed. On my bicycle, it will take about between 15 and 20 minutes, depending on the traffic.
This was interesting because I was riding along by Lake Scudero there and saw this beautiful garden right on the banks of the lake, and chap watering his plants, and my water bottle on the bike was empty, so I went across to the gate and asked him if he'd fill me water bottle. Fortunately, everybody in Norway seems to speak English, so there was no problem. And he disappeared into the house, and a few minutes later he came out. The water bottle was full of strawberry cordial, and he got another glass of it in his hand, which he gave me to drink. And considering he'd never seen me in his life before, I thought that was really marvellous.
I remember going to our first veteran cycle rally. I only went as a spectator. Somebody came to me very excited after the event and said, "John, what do you think about these old bikes? Aren't they fantastic? Are you going to get one?" And I said, "You must be joking. Never in the rain of pig's pudding will you see me with one of these things." And we've got that many now that we barely know what to do with them. It's just gone on. It's like Topsy, it's just growed. They've become my whole life. I eat, sleep and drink the things now. And I've not found anything better.
It's not exactly a display. It's stuff that we've collected for our own pleasure rather than one-upmanship, if you like. You know, I mean, we like bicycles. It's as simple as that. And anything that we find that's got a bicycle motif on, then, provided it's not a ridiculous price, then we'll buy it. And it's part of our collection. We get a lot of fun out of it. And most of the stuff comes very, very cheaply, and there's so much of it about. Carrier bags. Dorothy's got quite a big selection of canvas carrier bags with bikes on of various sorts and prints.
Anything with bicycles on, we collect. Greetings cards, postcards, bicycles on tins, plates, cups, storage jars, all sorts, with bicycles on. But there's bells and lamps, tea towels and aprons. It's all got some interest, which is very, very pleasing to the eye. And we can have a talk about it and see if anybody else has found the same piece. Not always. We're lucky because we fetch so much stuff from abroad, which people don't see in this country. And those are very nice as well.
I like riding all of my machines. I don't have a favourite. The machine I'm on at the moment is the one that I like. There are some that I quite like to get off fairly quickly as well, but, you know, I can enjoy all the bicycles that I've got. Oh, you get the usual sort of comments. Most of them are frivolous and meaningless, but you do get a lot of people who appreciate seeing the machines out again. My aim is to have one of all of the different types of machines that make up cycle history. When I was 16 years old, I started motorcycling. And it wasn't until I was married and we got two young boys and we were very much involved in the Vintage Motorcycle Club that I realised that my family were just an appendage to the Vintage Motorcycle combination and myself. They were just, it was like another extra. It was like having an acetylene lamp or a ball horn or something. So I found that the cycle activity, the historic cycle activity, gave my wife and also my two sons the opportunity to become their own characters and do their own things. All the bits and pieces that have been collected will be restored. There's nothing that I personally feel is impossible. The thing about it all is, at the end of the day, when you've made something, you've actually produced something there, and you can go and do something with it. I can understand people collecting stamps because there's a certain fascination there, but when you've got a book full of stamps, I think when you've looked at them twice, that tends to be a bit terminal. But with my work, you can actually go and use the machine. Who knows, perhaps in a couple of years' time I might tire of them and want to do something else. I think it's very unlikely.
Actually, this is a tent I made myself. I wanted it this shape, and I couldn't buy a tent this shape. There is a Scandinavian firm makes a tent this shape, but it's too big for what I want. So I borrowed their design and adapted it for my own use. And I found it a very, very useful shape altogether. The last time I used it, I'd been to visit my brother-in-law in Suffolk. I was riding back, and I wanted a place to camp, and I camped by one of their dikes. It was a lovely, secluded spot, and the only notice up was they didn't want anybody. There was a footpath went over the stile. I didn't need it, but people warned against fishing. That was prohibited, but said nothing about camping. And it's 180 miles from Sheffield. I measured it on my cyclometer. And I got there in 2.5 days. I did about 70 the first day, 80 the second, and I was due to be there for lunch on the Sunday, and I was there with a 30-mile ride in the morning.
Well, I'm 87. I should be 88 in October. Now, I don't live in the past. I live for the future, and I think cycling's a part of the future. It's got everything that the future ought to offer, and I'm flatly opposed to the present ethos of accumulating wealth and spending as much as possible when a simpler life is far more satisfactory and far more worthwhile, in my judgment.
all I do, as far as cooking's concerned for breakfast, is to make a cup of tea. It's quite simple. And when that boils, I get the first tea and add some more water and finish off the process. So that's all the cooking I do in the tent.
I go around cooking for businessmen and do three-course lunches and cakes and cookies and bread and things like that. I pull it on a bike because I don't have to rely on trying to catch a taxi or getting wheel clamped or parking tickets. I park right outside and get my booty out and it's quite easy. I do this about half a year, do my cooking and then go off cycle touring abroad if I can.
Yes, now this was another very helpful chap I met. I was riding along and saw a church the other side of the road, and I thought I'd like to have a look, see what the Norwegian churches were like inside. And he got the key, he opened the church for me, and he also opened up this triptych reredos, which apparently is quite a unique feature of the church. And he opened it up specially so that I could take a photograph of it. This is one of the very few occasions when I use flash, actually.
Lean.
Come on, girl, you have to work at this one.
Oh, 50 yards, come on. Oh, another 50. Oh. It's a tandem trike, obviously a three-wheeler tandem, built by a mate of mine from Stoke-on-Trent, George Longstaff, to my, well, my ideas and his ideas have been incorporated in it. And it was a bit of a battle as to whose ideas came out on top in the end, but probably it was a draw. We race on it, tour on it, go down to the pub on it, use it as our major means of conveyance for the family.
Airplanes!
Mummy!
Airplanes!
All right.
The people that buy a machine off us are serious, and they want a tool to do a job, and they want the best tool available to do that job. Now, whether they're riding the Tour de France or whether they're doing a trip around the world, we can offer them the machine to do it. We take something like 12 different body dimensions to derive at what is needed. And then the frame is designed to do the particular job that they want it to do. Very, very few of the really specialist machines are resold. As I say to every customer, the machine's never theirs, it's just on a lifelong lease. because really you can't sell your workmanship. The customer becomes the owner of it, but you cannot sell it because it's always there. When I see the machines out, I still look over them, and I must admit, as a few customers have found out, I don't like it if the machines have been neglected or if the machines have been abused, because they weren't made for that tramp to them. My own wife got killed when she was supervising my daughter, or taking her to a cycle race, and they were riding along the road towards the start of the event when a small minicar pulled out of a farm drive in front of them. The wife got killed virtually instantly, and my daughter got very badly injured. It hasn't affected my attitude towards cycling, because cycling didn't kill my wife. It was a motorist that killed my wife. It was an accident. Accidents will happen. And it's just unfortunate that happened to be my wife.
The first man to ride from Land's End to John O'Groats was in 1885. Jay Lennox, and it took him 6 days, 16 hours and 7 minutes. And that was on what is properly known as an ordinary, or to most people, it's a penny farthing. Funnily enough, I've always thought it was a silly old thing to do, really, you know, sitting on a bike for 2 days, but other men over 100 years had attempted it, and I thought I'd just like to have a go. After 2 hours, you start to feel tired, and then 4 hours, you're more tired, and I did really worry as to whether I could just keep going for that length of time, because I'd never ridden that far before. I can always remember I got to Exeter, I think that was 120 miles, and I did that in 5 hours, which is 24 miles an hour. As the ride progressed, my actual road speed dropped. My average speed for the whole event was 18.9 miles an hour. So most of the time I was doing about 20 miles an hour. In fact, I broke the record when I was 45 years of age, and I'm now 52, and I definitely don't feel I've got the physique to do that anymore. The object of the exercise is not to get off the bicycle at all, but I personally found that impossible. The first real stop was at Tewkesbury. I put on night clothing, had a wash, and had some food sitting down. It's all right for the first 2 hours, but as the ride progresses, eating on the bicycle isn't all that pleasant. And then I more or less rode non-stop. I didn't sleep at all. I was extremely worried that although the weather conditions when I set out were good, I was
worried they would deteriorate, and in fact, if I had a very strong headwind over the second day, in particular, considering I'd be very tired on the second day, then the record would have failed. Those racing cyclists are difficult to live with. I can train up to 2 hours without it interfering too much with my family life. But to train for Lands End John O'Groats, I mean, it was such a major undertaking. I've had to spend a lot of time riding, about 8 hours a day. My route was 847 miles in record-breaking time. One day, 21 hours, 3 minutes and 16 seconds. Well, I was absolutely exhausted. My ankles were a little bit swollen and I think I had a sore throat. I couldn't. For me, I'm a keen cyclist. I ride every day without fail, and yet I didn't ride for, I think, 6 days after the attempt because I had a sore bum.
Jacket, gloves.
And it just weren't needed.
All you needed is shorts and a jersey.
That's it.
That
kind but you're not to know.
You don't
you?
Know at no, the time. No, we bombed along.
Once you built your speed up, you're not so bad.
Yeah, I tucked him behind Bob, and away we went. Thoroughly enjoyed it. Smashing, you know.
Yeah. So you don't hit any hills. That's what's going to slow
it
you.
It was
with.
Flat. Made a smashing 10 course.
It's a 1951 frame that was made up into a bike in 1952.
It's not the kind of bike you can sit back and forget it.
No, you've got to ride it. Yeah.
Add the top tube length. Mine's
double cheese.
It may be that I've got the wrong
cheese and a spare. Right.
Won't be that.
29 is double cheese.
We're very thin on the ground, these kind of cafes. You know, we've been doing quite a bit of touring around the country, and we haven't found another one quite like this. I don't think there's anywhere quite like this.
It was a joke.
It wasn't really serious. Mrs. Yarrington said she was selling the place, and I thought, well, it did suit Anne, because at that particular time she was the lollipop lady where we lived in Harden, about 5 miles away. She used to stop the cyclists coming down the hill with her lollipop stick on Wednesdays when they were coming back here for their, you know, for their tea. And I got home from the committee meeting and we talked about it. The following day when I got home from work, the estate agents had been round and given us the valuation for our house.
It's been Eureka now for 60-odd years. Started off with a little room, and then the war came and rations were hard to get, but the cafe kept going as a cyclist cafe. I looked after them if they were poorly. I used to give them tumblers and stuff. And if they came off the bicycles, I used to dress their bottoms and their elbows and their cheeks. I said I wouldn't sell it only to a cyclist because there was a building plot, planning permission for a bungalow here. And I didn't advertise it because I knew a builder would come along. And he would have demolished all this or used this as part of the bungalow, I don't know. And I didn't want that to happen. I felt it would have been 60 years wasted, which of course it would have been. So it's like I said, if I die tomorrow, I feel that I've done something with my life, because even though I'll never know, I know that this will always go on as Eureka.
It's if you get one that's really comfortable and you really feel happy on it, you do.
It tends to be much faster in response.
There's quite a lot of the old ones come. I think it's a kind of home from home. They come and reminisce on a quiet Wednesday. They're outside on the benches when the weather's nice. We closed one Wednesday recently and they were sort of aimlessly wandering about, nowhere to go.
Don't have a lot of variety. There's cheese on toast, beans on toast, egg on toast.
Any combination?
Any combination. And now we do sandwiches and soup.
Cakes.
Cakes.
Several people come in for...
Which they call soggy
and
cake.
And soggy cake. There's certainly plenty of miles in hand on big cake. It goes down well. Basically what cyclists need. We get the odd family that come in and actually want chips, look up the menu and then go away again. Cyclists don't really want too many chips. It's just the beans to get you home, basically. We get through tons of beans.
Actually, I haven't got any Pacific opening times. As soon as the first cyclist comes, that's it, I'm open. And even when I'm closed and they want to drink,
coming round.
Knock on the window or on the door and I... let them in and make them a drink in the house. Because they know they don't have to pay for it in the house, you see. It's free.
You'll be full of customers during the week now, then.
Yeah, I know. I love it.
Yeah.
I love it. And the lads are a smashing bunch.
This was the piece de resistance from the photographic point of view. This is the youth hostel at Leardall, in the middle of the picture there. I spent a bit of time walking round that lake to get the reflections, but I was very pleased with that.
If something goes wrong after 6 months, we've done what most people don't do in their lifetime. Mm.
I think things that frighten you could be, for some people, or people say to us, when you come back and all this, but if you thought about everything in too much detail, I don't think you'd ever go. I don't think anybody ever do anything if you thought too much about it.
We've budgeted to come back to no money. We've budgeted to spend all this money on this trip. So theoretically, we'll come back to the United Kingdom with nothing. And everybody seems to ask, well, what are you going to do, you know, what are you going to do for a house and all this? And
but
we just think, two and a half years' time, we'll worry about it then.
One of the first things I want to go and see is the Statue of Liberty, because it represents freedom. It's there welcoming everybody into America. And that's what I think me and Christopher have got in our hands. We've got freedom for 2.5 years, and we're going to go out there and make the most of it.
That's a lot, isn't it? Yes, out and return to Newcastle, yeah. It's 2 nights on the boat coming back. That's the worst part of Norway, the journey. I mean, I was more tired when I got back on the boat than I had been going over 4,000 foot paths. It's very tiring, the journey. It was 1 night on the boat going and 2 nights on the boat coming back. And then there's a journey back by train from Newcastle to London, so I was quite tired the time I got home.
So would you say that's your favourite journey?
Hmm?
Would you say that's your favourite journey?
I didn't enjoy the public transport part, the boat and the train, but the actual touring was magnificent. And the people were magnificent. The scenery was magnificent. It was a wonderful country.